Let's talk about bloom filters. Not to be confused with the bloom shader effect, a bloom filter is a simple probabilistic set originally conceived by Burton Bloom. Yeah, it's not some weird mathematical bloom, it's just his last name. Suppose you run a website where users post links. 99% are cat pictures, cool new websites, and YouTube videos. But every once in a while, someone posts a link to a known malicious site which you want to block. There's millions of known bad links, so you pay for a service that keeps a list of them that you can query. Calling out to the service costs money and slows down your response times to your users, so you'd really like to know whether a link is bad without querying the service. But with, say, 10 million bad links and considering overhead, it could easily take a gig of extra RAM if you just stored all the data in a Python set. With a bloom filter, we could cut down on 98% of calls to the service using only 10 megabytes of extra memory. But before we see how a bloom filter can help your website, first you're going to need a website, so please consider this video's sponsor, Hostinger, for all your web hosting needs. Hostinger just happens to be running their biggest ever Black Friday sale, where you can get their business plan for as little as $3.49 a month. If you just want to tinker, there's also the premium plan, which goes as low as $1.99 a month, and comes with everything you need to get started, like a free domain, email, and SSL certificates. But if you want to run a site with some real traffic, I recommend the business plan, which additionally comes with increased performance and access to Hostinger's CDN. When you check out, make sure to use coupon code MCODING to get an additional 10% off on top of the Black Friday deals. Choose your free domain and use the website builder if you're a novice, or deploy your site straight from GitHub if you're a pro. And don't forget to use my custom link in the description to let them know that I sent you. Let's get back to bloom filters. A bloom filter is kind of like a set in that you can add things to it, and it quickly tells you whether an element is in the set. Except when you ask if an element is in the set, it either tells you possibly yes or definitely no. In other words, if it tells you no, the element is 100% not in the set. But if it tells you yes, there's a small chance the answer is actually no. Oh yeah, and you can't remove elements from a bloom filter either. If you need to remove something, you need to create a whole new one from scratch. You're probably thinking, this sounds like a worse version of a set. Why would I ever want a data structure that has a restricted interface and gives me incorrect results? Like many probabilistic data structures, the answer is that by giving up a bit in accuracy and flexibility, we can save an enormous amount in performance. The catch is that you need a use case where mistakenly identifying an element as in the set when it's not is okay. That often occurs when you have a fast way to compute something that works for most but not all elements, and a much more expensive way to compute the same thing that always works. For our website, we can use a bloom filter to tell us yes, a link is possibly bad, or definitely no, this link is not a known bad link. If the bloom filter says a link is possibly bad, we fall back to the paid service to give us a reliable answer, so it's fine if we get a false positive in a small percentage of cases. That's still a win compared to sending everything to the paid service. Great, so how does a bloom filter work? Think about identifying objects by their shadows. Shadows contain much less data than the originals. But given an object, you can usually tell whether it's part of a shadow. Yes, the shadows could conspire to trick you into seeing something that isn't there, but in reasonable cases, you can work around it. A bloom filter consists of a block of memory that's m bits long, along with some number k of hash functions. In order to add an item to the set, we hash it using each hash function and set the bit at the corresponding memory location to 1. This pattern of bits from the hash functions is like the object's shadow. Then, to query whether an element's in the set, we look for its shadow by using each hash function and checking whether all the corresponding bits are set. If any bit is a 0, then this item was definitely not added to the set. If every bit's a 1, it's either because the element is actually in the set, or because some combination of other elements happened to set those bits. So we can, at best, say the element is possibly in the set. That's really all there is to the bloom filter. It uses a fixed amount of memory, no matter how many elements you add, and the time it takes to add or query elements only depends on how many and how slow your hash functions are, not how many elements were added already. Its implementation is rather simple, we'll get to that later. All the difficulty lies in analyzing how much memory and how many hash functions to use. If we use m bits of memory, k hash functions, and added n items, what's the chance of falsely identifying an element as in the set when actually it's not? In real life, it depends, measure it, but we can get a good approximate answer if we assume the hash functions select bits uniformly and independently for distinct elements. For a fixed bit, the chance that one hash of a single element will set that bit is 1 over m, so the chance that the bit is not set is 1 minus that. For k independent hash functions to all not set that bit, we raise that to the power k. And repeating this for n total elements, we raise that to the power n. This is the chance that this fixed bit is not set after adding n elements. Therefore, the chance this fixed bit is set after adding n elements is 1 minus that, and a false positive means that k fixed bits have all been set, so we raise that to the power k to finally arrive at our estimate of the false positive rate. You can start plugging in numbers if you want, or using calculus, we can approximate this as follows. Multiply and divide by m, and then use the limit definition of e, and then rearrange. Notice the quantity m over n is something meaningful to us. That's how many bits of storage we've allocated per element. If we fix that quantity to, say, 1 byte per element and plot, we see that we don't need a huge number of hash functions. In fact, the error rate is minimized using around 5 hash functions. More generally, using calculus, take derivatives, set to 0, etc., you can show that we can achieve an error rate as small as we like by choosing the number of hash functions to be about log base 2 of the desired error rate, and the number of bits per element to be about 1.44 times that. So if we're okay with around a 2% false positive rate, then we could use 5 or 6 hash functions and 8 bits per element. For 10 million elements, that's just 10 megabytes of data, regardless of how large each element is, because the Bloom filter doesn't store the actual elements. Okay, but where can I get k different hash functions for my data? Instead of inventing a bunch of hash functions, there are a few tricks you can do, like using a hash function that takes a seed or appending k different suffixes to your data before hashing. But here's a trick that can get the job done using just one good hash function. If I'm using 10 megabytes of memory, that's 80 million bits, so my hash functions need to output numbers up to 80 million. Higher's fine, we'll just mod by the length, but we need at least up to 80 million. Log base 2 of 80 million is 26.25, so my hashes really only need to be 27 bits long. How about I use a 256-bit hash, and then just split the first 240 bits into 5 chunks of 48 bits? Treat each chunk as a separate hash function, and now I've got 5 48-bit hash functions that I can use for my Bloom filter. Obviously, if you need many more hash functions, there won't be enough bits and this trick won't work. But for our use case, it does work. Now let's implement it. It's super simple. This is the whole implementation. We take in the memory and a function that computes the hashes. I chose to use a function that outputs multiple hashes rather than to store a list of hash functions because hashes may share computation. Like first computing the 256-bit hash, then splitting that into 5 48-bit chunks, there's no need to recompute the 256-bit hash 5 times. Estimating the false positive rate is just plugging into the formula we had earlier in the video. Adding an element means calculating each hash and setting the corresponding bit to 1. And checking if an element is in the set means calculating each hash and checking whether any of the corresponding bits are not set. Here we see how to split the output of a hash function into smaller ones, which is pretty straightforward. The last gotcha we need to work around is that in Python, if we use a list of integers as our underlying memory for the Bloom filter, that's going to be using 8 bytes per index, because under the hood, Python will store a pointer to the unique cached 0 or 1 int object at each index location. That's 64 times more memory than the 1 bit per index we assumed in our analysis. Therefore, to really make use of a Bloom filter, we should use something like a bit array that uses 1 bit per index. We can implement a bit array like this. Have it hold the data, which is made of an array of bytes, and a size. We keep track of the size separately because we might want to store a number of bits that's not a multiple of 8, so the array might be a few bits longer than the size. We can construct an array of zeros like this, allocating a byte for every 8 bits, rounded up. Getting a bit is just calculating which byte and which bit within the byte using divmod, then grabbing that index and masking out the bit we want. Setting a bit is similar. This first expression, we do a bitwise AND to clear the bit, then the second one, we do a bitwise OR to set the value we want. Putting it all together, we can use it like this. We define a hash function, in this case, we just use SHA-256, and convert the result to an int. We split our long hash into 5 hashes that use 6 bytes or 48 bits each. Then we create our storage as a bit array initialized to zeros and create the Bloom filter. I made a little timer utility here that just times each operation, not important. We create 10 million random length 16 strings and add them to the Bloom filter. Note that we're using a huge amount of memory here because we continue to store the strings in memory. For the malicious link detection use case, we could add all the links to the bloom filter and then serialize just the bloom filter to distribute to our servers. The servers don't need to keep all the individual links, so they would only need that extra 10 megabytes of memory for the bloom filter, not gigabytes for all the strings. Just to check our implementation, we assert that there are no false negatives, meaning that everything that we did add returns true when we check whether it's there. Then we count false positives by querying an equal number of strings that were not added to the filter and compare with the estimated false positive rate based off our mathematical analysis. Amazingly, we find a 2.169 false positive rate, which is stunningly close to the estimated 2.168% estimate. Everything was completely random, and yet we predicted the answer with great precision. Probability is pretty cool. Anyway, you probably noticed these times are really long, which is caused by the fact that we're committing the cardinal sin of doing a numerical hot loop in Python for 10 million iterations. This won't really be an issue in production, since you're going to be bottlenecked by waiting on the network way before this makes any difference, but if you really want to, I'm sure you could find a decent C extension that implements a bloom filter. My name is James Murphy, my company is M-Coding, and we do software consulting, and once again, thank you to this video's sponsor, Hostinger. Don't forget to check out their current sale and use coupon code MCoding at checkout. You can use my personalized link in the description. Also, thanks to my patrons and donors. See you in the next one.